Okay, so today we are going to start with microeconomics basically, and the standard starting point is demand and supply. Although it's a fact that we will arrive demand once we do consumer behavior. And finishing consumer behavior, we will have the backbone, which is behind this word demand, okay? And for supply, there are a few chapters, few topics. But here we are going to start with directly the demand and supply, their curves and so on and so forth, okay? So, to start with, what is the definition of demand itself? So it is want backed by purchasing power. Want backed by purchasing power. So behind the word demand, the idea is pretty simple, that I want something, and this want is actually kind of wishful thinking, one can say. All right, and within that wishful thinking, so there is no idea of in this want, there is no idea of necessity, there is no idea of anything of that sort. It's just wishful thinking. And to that extent, we will actually implicitly assume that this want is essentially unlimited, although it is obviously limited by what you know to want, but theoretically speaking, this want is unlimited, and that is backed by purchasing power. That is, demand is basically then the realization of this want. Demand essentially talks about the realization of this want, and for that purchasing power is needed. Purchasing power, essentially, it obviously has a very everyday English meaning, but it also has a very specific meaning in terms of statistical index. We have a very concrete meaning towards what actually means purchasing power, apart from the very simple idea of a very simple definition of what money can buy. Anyway, so this is our idea of rather definition of demand, which has two competing things. One is want, and here is the purchasing power, which acts as a sort of, not sort of, it acts as a basically restriction. Okay. So now how this restriction actually works, that we'll study later. But for the time being, we take this definition of demand, and to some extent we understand it in the way we understand everyday things. Okay, now, within this demand, if I ask the question how this demand is formed or what are the reasons, then we enter into the determinants of demand. And for that, currently we are interested in the demand of a single commodity. Or not of, rather, demand for a single commodity. All right. And just to list some of them, obviously own price. So that is PX, where X is the commodity. Okay. The number two is income of the individual. So we denote it sometimes by M or I. Okay, and it depends basically on the problem and also on the book. Number three is price of other goods. Price of other goods. So that can be written as PY, PZ, etc. And this price of other goods, its effect on the demand of the commodity X that we are talking about, it depends on the kind of relationship that this X shares with Y and Z. Depending on that, the effect of this price changes. Okay, so it can have a positive influence, it can have a negative one also, or it can have no effect at all in case these two goods will be unrelated. Okay, and obviously tastes and preference. So this is the only reason we are writing, which is coming from want, right? This taste and preference comes from want. Obviously, there are many other reasons which certainly we are not listing now, because these are the four things that we are interested in. And even again, when we'll be analyzing how demand is generated, in which we are not currently interested. We just started with the fact that there is demand, which is this more of a English kind of a definition. Anyway, so why these four? Because these are the four major reasons that we consider to be more effective more effective in determining demand. So when we'll be doing the how part of the demand later, then you'll observe that these four components, they are becoming the most important, and will work actually only in these four. Okay, but what it essentially says is that if I'm even talking about demand, I don't talk about everything that has an effect. We talk about those things which we think are most important. That means, what do you mean by importance here? Importance means, what is the effect of changing any of these on demand typically? So with sync, so by this ordering, what we actually think is that the highest effect on the demand for a single commodity is by its price. So if PX changes, the changes in demand will be quite effective. That is, we have to note it. And then income, and then other goods, and obviously taste and preference. Okay, so the importance means basically the fact that we are considering how the demand for goods changes, the amount of change, okay, for which it is more, it's more important to us. Okay, so now if we try to construct a demand function. So let's start with generalized demand function, which means that in this function, we are trying to include as much variable as possible. So if I'm looking for a demand function, then that demand function, let me write as some dx, it will be a function of px, py, pz, then money, and that is income. And if I write some t, so tastes and many more, okay. So if I'm going to look at a construction of a function, there are many variables. That is the first thing. The second thing is that, just to mention, each of them in this generalized function, each is an argument. So from a generalized standpoint, this demand function is essentially multivariate. That is, there are too many endogenous variables. And for the time being, our interest is more on the own price of the commodity. Okay, we can have a demand function which involves all of this, but then that will be hard to work with. Not in the sense of, I mean, not more in sense of mathematics, but more in sense of capturing the essence of demand. Okay. So as I was saying, that when I'm drawing a function, demand function, for example, here, I'm not really interested in knowing what is the demand. My actual interests are two. Number one is obviously that how demand is affected by something. And obviously the next is the role of this demand in market equilibrium. So second, we'll come to that. But since this is a multivariate structure and we think that this price has the maximum effect on demand, and we are also interested in the relationship between these two, we make what is famously known as ceteris paribus assumption. Ceteris paribus assumption. Ceteris paribus is a Latin phrase which means keeping everything else constant. Keeping everything else constant. Now, that's fine. So we choose actually to keep all arguments of demand function other than Px, that is own price, to be constant. Okay. And by doing that, we think that actually the function becomes like this. By doing that, that is making all other arguments constant. Generally, our idea is that we make the demand function like this, but this is not really the complete picture. What is happening? By this assumption, we have created two partitions or two divisions. One is the variable Px, which we call endogenous, or a variable. And rest of this, that is other prices, income, and all, they are called, so they are exogenous or parameters. Parameters. Okay. So let's take a detailed look on this. So going by notation, after ceteris paribus assumption, we actually should write the demand function like this, Px, then there is a semicolon, then income and prices of other goods, etc. That's how we should write it. But generally, we prefer to write this as D equal to F of Px. It's because since these are given from outside, we don't write them because they, while determining demand using this function, when I'm determining demand using this function, since their values are given from outside, they do not really determine demand through this function. Okay. in the sense Px determines. So the argument that Px becomes is something different from all of these. All right, so as I was saying, that this divides the two things. This is endogenous variable. And what is an endogenous variable? Endogenous variable basically means that variable which the value of which is determined by the system. So value of Px will be determined in the system. In the system. And they are, as I said, that they are exogenous. So they are, these value of them are given from outside. Okay. Now, what do you mean by determined in the system? This means that the equilibrium of the market, so market equilibrium that we are referring to, this will determine Px. But they are will not be determined by the market equilibrium. Not only that, there is a second application or second effect of having endogenous and endogenous means inside, exogenous variables at, in the same function. And what is that? This is that if the value of endogenous variables of endogenous variable changes, we move along the graph. We move along the graph and if the value of exogenous variable changes, there will be shift of the graph. Okay, so you'll see to that. In our context, in our specific context, what it means that if there is a change in own price, we move along the demand curve, and if anything else changes, then we move, then there is a shift of the demand curve. Okay, so anything this the value of which is given from outside, the value of which is not being determined in the by the equilibrium, that change in that change in the value of that variable essentially shifts the graph of the function. That's the idea. Okay. So now, from function, we move to graph, which will give us the demand curve that we draw or see quite frequently. So what is that? It shows the relationship. It shows the relationship between, so then again, this is my abbreviation. So between the quantity of a good, the quantity of a good a consumer is willing to buy, so that's another way of writing want, the consumer is willing to buy, and the price of the good. So when I'm saying demand, I'm talking about the amount, First of all, the amount the consumer actually buys. So to that extent, demand is observable. I can really see it. And also how that changes with different prices of the commodity. Okay. So now, since price is something that we pay because we want to buy, it is only natural to think that the relationship between demand of a commodity and its price is negative. But it's not the only kind of relationship also, but this is the general one. This is the more common one. And unless stated otherwise, we'll work with that. So that brings us to law of demand. So law of demand has two components. Number one is, if there is an increase, if there is an increase in the price of a commodity, in the price of a commodity, there will be a decrease. There will be a decrease in the quantity demanded. In the quantity demanded. Now, this is something that we know. Number two is, and this is important, there exists an one-to-one correspondence, between correspondence between quantity demanded and price. Now, what is the role of this second one? Second component, it is basically this one-to-one correspondence. What it technically says, now, correspondence has a very unique mathematical meaning, exact mathematical meaning. But for the timing, we'll take a restricted version of it, by which we are talking about basically a function. So we have written that demand function dx, demand, is basically a function of px. Now, we have never said that there is actually a function. That is, we can actually write the function, okay? So it may be the case that there is a relation between prices of a commodity and demand. And that's fine, but that doesn't guarantee that there is a function. That is, for every price, every value of price, I'll get a unique value of demand, okay? So that is not guaranteed outright by the law. The law, the first component of the law, this is very simple. Price increases, demand decreases, and vice versa. But here, we have something which will allow us, first of all, to write this okay, because there is a one-to-one correspondence like this. And second is that given this second reason, one-to-one correspondence, we can also draw the demand curve that we want to draw so much. So this guarantees that when price increases, for every smaller increase in price even, there is indeed a change in quantity demanded, okay? So dx equal to f of px, and then given the law, I can write that f of px is negative. Now, this is called the direct demand function. It's called the direct demand function. However, Alfred Marshall worked with the other version, that is, so to say, the inverse of it. So quantity demanded actually px is equal to, by this context, f inverse of dx, or as we sometimes write, f of q d simply. Okay, so quantity demanded. And obviously here also f dash q d is negative. This demand function is called inverse demand function. And this is the kind of function which is attributed to Alfred Marshall. Okay. So although the structure that we started with, it asks us to put price as the argument, what we do in economics is we take quantity as the argument. All right. And that is due to Marshall. So later when we'll be constructing, when we'll be actually finding Marshallian demand function, okay, unlike this time where demand functions will be sort of given, there we'll observe that when we draw the demand function itself, we draw it like this, but obviously writing the demand function, we solve it in this form so that x or quantity is a function of price. Anyways, so let's take two examples that will make the scenario clear, and then we'll draw one representative demand function. Okay. So as an example of the direct demand function, it will be quantity demanded. This is 160 minus 40p. So this is my direct demand function. But when we draw, we don't really draw it. What we draw is the inverse of it. Okay. So to have an example, we draw p equal to 40 minus 0.025 QD. So that is what we draw. Okay. So in general, then we take q in the x-axis, which actually changes which actually makes us draw the inverse demand function, and which goes like this, I mean, in general. So either you can write QD or you can write D. Both are notations used by books. So if I take two points, P1, Q1, P2, Q2. So the first part of the law tells me that there is a negative relation, that is, if P1 reduces, then Q will increase. And the second part of the law tells me that indeed the Q1, which is related to P1, and the Q2, which is related to P2, they are different. Okay, so basically I can draw it like this. Okay, so in the similar way, we can draw this one also. Now, to draw the graph of a function, there are two alternative ways, or rather, we'll put it like this, that actually they merge into one. So what is the way? Let's look at it like this. So what is the way to draw the graph of demand function, or any graph for that matter? We need two things. Number one is we need the intercepts on both axes. So that is the first thing that we need. And the second is we need the slope. We need the slope. So given these two, we can draw it. And for that matter, by intercept, I mean, for a curve, when you are drawing a curve, we are not, it's not always the case that we'll get the intercepts. So these two are more applicable, let's say, for a straight line. Okay. So for a curve, what do we need? We need two points. And since in the straight line, the slope doesn't change, knowing the slope will make me able to draw a straight line. But if it becomes a curve, then we need a third one, and that is the second order differential. That we'll also need if I'm drawing a curve. But for the time being, intercept and slope will do just fine. So in that case, let's just say we'll have a demand function which looks like this. So here it will be 0, 40, and here it will be 160, 0. Okay. So now we said that there are two categories of variables that we are dealing here with. One is endogenous and the other is exogenous. So for the endogenous variable, a change in that will make us movement along the demand curve. And there is exogenous variable, a change in which will make us, will shift the demand curve. Okay. Now, so movement along the demand curve. And there is only one case in which this happens, and that is PX changes. What about shift of the demand curve? Anything but PX changes. So anything apart from PX changes, you have a shift. Now, the shift there is a way in which we write what happens at shift of a demand curve, and that is that quantity demanded changes, so there will be increase or decrease changes at all levels of price. So this is the English sentence that we write when we try to elaborate the shift of the demand curve. Okay, so to draw a very simple diagram, so if I take two points A and B, then A to B is change in Px, that is movement along the demand curve, and shift means that if it is outward shift, that is this D naught is going into D1, then at P1 the available quantity increased, at P2 the available the available quantity increased, and so at all the other levels of prices. Okay, so now when at some level we are done with the effect of own price of the good, let's move on to what happens when the price of the other good changes. So as we said, that when the price of the other good changes, it may or may not affect the demand of the commodity that we are talking about. And not only that, it may have effect in the positive direction, it may have effect also in the negative direction. So in the case when they are not affected, so they are unrelated. But in the case when Qx, let's say, is affected by Py, the change can be positive or negative. And depending on that, we have substitutes and complements. Substitutes and complements. So here we are interested in Qx and Py. So quantity change of one good and price change of another good. Okay. So let us go with substitutes. So definition of substitutes. So two goods are substitutes. Two goods are substitutes if an increase in the price of one good leads to an increase in the quantity demanded of the other good. Okay. So look at how, what are the important parts of this sentence that I have written. So first of all, we need two goods. So earlier we are talking about one good. And then, this is one thing that always write quantity demanded, never write the demand of the other good. Okay, so they are, technically they mean very different things. Quantity demanded of the other good is the correct way of writing it. Don't just write flatly demand of the other good, because if I say demand of the other good, then that will mean something very different. All right. So that will actually refer to something else. I mean, it will refer to a kind of shift. Anyways, so here what I see is that the relationship is positive. So basically, we are looking at a positive relationship. That's what substitute stands for. Substitute means replacement. So if I can replace one commodity by the other, so going by demand, the chain is very simple. So there is a commodity X of which there is a demand QX and a price PX. And there is a commodity Y which can actually potentially replace it, X, in terms of demand. And for that we have quantity and price. So when PY increases, following the law of demand, QY decreases. And since QY decreases, QX comes in and takes the place of Y. So X comes in and takes the place of Y because Y is costly now. So in that way, the demand for QX increases. We can look at it in a slightly different way also. And it is this, that if I take the relative price between X and Y, so this is the relative price of X and Y. If there is an increase in PY, that means the relative price of X, not and Y, the relative price of X in terms of Y. So relative price of X in terms of Y. So now if I look at this in this way, look at this. So if PY increases, the relative price of X actually decreases. And since this is meaningful because X can actually replace Y, so if the relative price of X decreases, the demand for it must increase. So if that occurs, we call them substitutes. Now, definitely, if there is a positive relation, there is a possibility that there is also a negative relation. And that negative relation leads us to complements. So following the same kind of writing, complements is something where QX and PY are negatively related. So in that sense, complement also means that complement means comes together. Okay, comes together, or in that sense, paired together. But remember one thing, that the fact that if X and Y are complement, that is, if PY increases, then QX falls or QX decreases, okay? You see, this occurs because complements come together. Now, it's not natural that they come together. It is because of your preference or the preference of the consumer that this occurs. So obviously, there are examples like pair of shoes. So if I think about left shoe of the left foot and then the right foot, then obviously there is no choice. You just can't go and buy one out of a pair. That's true. But in some cases, but in more, actually more, but normally this coming together is basically a result of preference of the consumer. So for example, if we talk about tea and sugar, or if we talk about probably butter and bread, right? So these are complement because of your preference, not because they are sold together or something, right? But pair of shoes is a classic example of complement, because without buying a pair, it becomes literally really meaningless. But that also kind of imposes the idea that complement is something natural imbibed in some goods. That's not true. Okay, there is no naturality to it. It happens because of the preference of the consumer. I mean, you have all the right to buy just one shoe, but it just doesn't, it will not make sense. Okay, but that doesn't say that it's the nature of complementarity is imbibed in shoes. That will be a wrong statement. Anyways, so now let's talk about it more on substitutes and complements. Let's look at the functional structure here. So just before we proceed, let's just look at the chain ones. So if I have some QX and I have some QY, I have some PX and I have some PY. So the idea is that if two goods are complement, the idea is that if PY increases, then obviously following the law of demand, QY decreases. Now, since for the consumer, X and Y, they come in pair, what is actually happening here? If the demand of Y decreases, it is for the consumer buying even same amount of X doesn't make sense. So because of that, the consumer actually decreases the demand for X, and that makes them complement. Okay. Now this buying doesn't make sense actually tells you that this tells you that the consumer prefer to buy in this manner. Okay. So for example, if I take the example of tea and sugar, so to say, sugar has many alternative uses. So it is not guaranteed really that if your demand for tea decreases, the demand for sugar will actually decrease. But that's why the kind of example we consider in complement, they are more of a typical. So one of them is shoes, then one is pen and refill. Okay, so pen and ink in that sense. All right, then mobile and charger. Okay, all of these are complements. Okay. So mobile and charger is probably the most common scenario. Okay. Now, there are some things to note. Number one is the word substitute can be divided into two parts. Number one is, perfect substitute. And by that, we essentially mean identical. I mean, they may not be identical, actually. Don't think that, I mean, if they're identical, then how can they be two different goods? But when I'm saying identical, that means identical in terms of purpose it serves. Okay. So that's that they are identical in terms of purpose they serve. So for example, if we are talking about beverages, then the choice that you have within the beverages, they are perfect substitute. I mean, they can be perfect substitute. However, perfect substitute is a very rare scenario. What we do have is imperfect substitute. That is very common. So tea and coffee, they are actually, obviously they are different. Okay, they taste different. Their prices are different. And their way of preparing them is also different. So to say that tea and coffee are perfect substitute, that will be wrong. But obviously they are imperfect substitute. And that's how reality is, that they are imperfect substitute. So they can be replacements, but not really a perfect one. Okay, but if the purpose served by the commodity remains the same. So for example, different kinds of pen, as long as they are of blue color or red color, they can be perfect substitute for anybody. So any pen will do for that matter. Okay. So they are substitute not in the sense that they are identical. They are substitute in the sense that the consumer is only concerned about writing and nothing more than that. Okay. So let's take a mathematical, let's look at the functional structure. So earlier we had Qx. Now if I involve the idea of substitute or complement, I must write that the demand for x is both a function of Px and Py. And if substitutes, if substitute, then f of Py will be positive. And if complement, f dash py will be negative. However, in our standard demand function, when we write q equal to f of px, in the demand function that we deal with, we do not mention py. Then what about diagram? How do we show this in the diagram when we have taken Py as exogenous, that is given from outside? So in that case, so if I treat Py as exogenous, then substitute means, substitute implies, okay, rightward shift of demand, rightward shift of demand curve. And similarly, complement implies leftward shift of the demand curve. Leftward shift of demand curve. And lastly, just to mention what we have said a lot of times, that if f dash py is equal to zero, which it can be, they are, let me write it like x and y are unrelated goods. X and y are unrelated goods. Okay, so these are the variations that we can think about. Now, as to the shape of demand curve, in general, obviously, it's negatively sloped. But there are two extreme cases of which we can talk about. So, extreme shapes of demand curve. And later we will analyze further what can we gather from such a demand curve. So one is this. So this is my demand curve. Okay. So this is obviously a vertical demand curve. And what we can easily see is that the demand doesn't really change if we change the price. So what will that mean? That will mean that here the equation of the demand function is QD equal to Q bar. That is, this is independent of Px. And this is the kind of demand we see for medicines or medical requirements. So for example, currently, this will be the demand curve for masks and sanitizers. And it is because of this, government came up and fixed the price of sanitizers at some level. Because if this is the demand curve, and if you are a seller, and if you are either selfish or rational, whatever you choose, you will actually try to increase the price of sanitizer as much as you can. Or maybe you will try to change the quality of the sanitizer as much as you can. So that's a bad practice. But there is a lot of incentive if the demand curve is this one of sellers or pharma companies making such a practice. Or other companies, any company for that matter, making sanitizers. So this is why government comes in and puts a price limit to that. Okay, so we'll study about all the such government interventions later. So now let us see the other extreme, which is when the demand curve is horizontal. So all of the demands appears at a price P bar. So here the equation is P equal to P bar. So all demands occur at this price. And if the price increases, the demand will be zero. And if the price decreases, obviously the demand cannot be zero. We actually consider it to be some form of some idea of infinity. I mean, in the sense that the farm or the market, it will not be able to serve that. So because of that, the market will probably not exist or something will happen. But anyways, the idea of horizontal demand curve is that all demands occurs at a single price. If that price changes, you will have no demand at all. Okay. So here we are, discussed the basics related to demand. So for example, what is the definition of it? What are the determinants? And when I'm writing the demand function, although I'm writing this, I'm actually not writing a lot of things. And it's not that they are not relevant. It is that we have taken other variables to be constant given from outside. And that brings us two different kinds of movement in the demand curve. One is moving along the curve and one is the shift of the curve, where quantity demanded increases at all levels of price. And then we introduce two terms, substitutes and complements, which are related to the price of the other good, which is not really written in the standard function. And then we just saw two very different extreme cases on which we will be talking a lot later after we study something called elasticity.